On that note, I'd like to begin today's lecture. This is, of course, Tchaikovsky's famous 1812 overture, a piece composed in 1880 to commemorate Russia's victory over Napoleon in the War of 1812 and 1814. And before I launch into the new themes of today, this slide is really devoted to the themes of last week in some ways, to the events that we talked about last week. And I want to just remind you of where we are and how far we've come. I think this piece of music is an appropriate way to begin this next lecture, to end the last one, because it is, in some ways, an important reminder of Napoleon's enormous impact on Europe and the world. In my last lecture, I introduced you to the idea of the making of a new person, a new man, a new individual, as fundamental and central to the promise of European modernity. We looked at the way in which that ideal of making a new human being goes back at least as far as the Renaissance. We looked at Leon Battista Alberti as an example of the first great Renaissance man, somebody who has enormous willpower, can jump over another human being, has enormous physical prowess as well as mental acumen, and how this vision of a new world improved and reinvigorated humanity is what Europe has, over the course of the last 500 years at least, promised the world. This is what modernity is all about, making us better versions of ourselves. And we concluded last lecture looking at Napoleon, a man who comes from nowhere, but becomes the most powerful person in the world. It's an empire larger than any since that of Genghis Khan. He wasn't a nobleman. Well, he was a minor nobleman in Corsica, but he wasn't an important Frenchman. He spoke French with an accent. The promise of being able to do whatever you want to be, take over the world, this seems to, in some ways, be embodied in the figure of Napoleon. But Napoleon is defeated by one power, Russia. And in defeating Napoleon, and later he is defeated again at Waterloo by the British, but it's an enormously important moment for Russian and European history, the defeat of Napoleon by Russia. It's in this moment, you could say, that Russian national identity, in a modern sense, is born. Almost all the great literary works of the 19th century refer back to this defeat in one way or another. Tolstoy's War and Peace, all about this battle with, or the war with Napoleon. Tchaikovsky's 1812 overture, they're still thinking about the War of 1812, 60, 70, 80, 90 years later. Napoleon's impact on Europe as well as Russia, I would argue to you, is at least threefold. And these are perhaps three different ways in which we can think about the way in which modernity evolves through the 19th century. Napoleon is important because he overturns practically every regime he encounters. He shows how temporary and impermanent the seemingly impermanent order of Europe is. There's no king that remains a king after Napoleon is done with him, basically. He takes over the thrones of Portugal, of Spain, of Italy. Nobody in Germany is left. He shows that a almost common person can completely remake the world order. This is enormously inspiring to those who are at the lowest level of society, and it's enormously frightening to those who are at the top. So Napoleon remakes by showing how impermanent the world order really is, by showing how it is really possible that everything that is solid might melt into air. Napoleon makes this tangible. So Napoleon's first impact is that of a revolutionary who overturns the world order. His second, I would say, role or impact is that of a role model. He inspires imitators all across Europe, all around the world. Literary works are devoted to him. Little Napoleons appear in fiction, and in reality as well. It's hard to find a single work, a major work of European literature in this middle of the 19th century that does not make some reference to Napoleon and what he has done to the world. And the third and perhaps most important way in which Napoleon reshapes the world, makes modernity, is by provoking resistance. You see this in the example of Russia, perhaps most clearly. Those who stand up to him, who oppose him, who declare that perhaps they don't want to go along with his system, perhaps they are the most modern people of all. In 1815, after the ultimate defeat of Napoleon, which I'm proposing to you here on the slide, is a new temporal frontier in European history, we can think about what unfolds thereafter throughout the 19th century as moving in at least two different directions. Napoleon, however reactionary or radical he was, promised a new world order. And so I have defined Napoleonic Europe, or associated Napoleonic Europe, with the new. And a year after his exile in 1816 on the island of St. Helena, he had some courtiers and admirers there who took notes on what he said and what he proclaimed. And he reported to one of them his great ambition, which is recorded here, to found a European system, a European code of laws, a European judiciary. His hope was that there would be but one people in Europe. The dream of a common Europe, in many ways, begins with Napoleon. We can find many different beginnings for the dream of a common Europe. But the notion that Europe is something more than its various nations and its states is one that Napoleon makes important and popular. In many ways, he embodies the continuation, or embodies the revolutionary spirit that led to his creation and to his success. The French Revolution of 1789, he is the direct outcome of that. And in my last lecture, I suggested to you that you might think about the Decembrist uprising in Russia in 1825 as participating in that same kind of revolutionary spirit. The Decembrists, the French revolutionaries, they all belong on the side of a vision of the new, a new that Napoleon embodies and incarnates in a really important way. Even those who oppose him, admire him enormously, as the example of Tolstoy or Dostoevsky demonstrates. In my last lecture, we also looked at some of the great literary works by which this promise of a new man was made, again, legible. And we've talked about Goethe's Faust as perhaps the most important, the most widespread legend, first of all, the Faustian legend, and then the Goethe's sort of version of it as a story of the making of a new world order, a world where we have to, in some sense, align ourselves with the forces of darkness in order to create a new world order that serves the interests of humanity. And I introduced you to Pushkin's Bronze Horseman, too. Story for Russia. This is the era in which countries start to seek their national poets. Goethe for Germany, Pushkin for Russia are two new examples. 1815, though, is an important moment because it casts some doubt, you could say, on the durability of Napoleon's legacy. Napoleon has been ultimately defeated. And the crowned heads of Europe that have come back to power want to create a world, ensure a world, where no Napoleon will ever again be possible. 1815 is the year of the Congress of Vienna, the year of a peace settlement or treaty that was supposed to make Napoleon's impossible, to restore old concepts of legitimacy. In many ways, 1815 is the birth of a political movement that you are very familiar with. As a coherent political movement is really born out of Napoleon's defeat. On the part of people who want to actively campaign for keeping the way things were or moving the world back. Conservatism can be distinguished. Traditionalism to traditions and the past. And as an act of ideology, it first becomes articulate, I would argue to you, after 1815. So who was on the side of this conservative ideology, the turning back to the past, refusing modernity in some ways, refusing the move to the future? The Holy Alliance, a political alliance of Prussia, Austria, and Russia that form in 1815 to protect Christian values against the threat of modernity and transformation. Lutheran Prussia, Catholic Austria, Orthodox Russia find in this moment at least greater common ground difference in proclaiming their devotion to the values of the past. The Russian czars, and I've introduced you to one of them last time, Alexander I. Alexander I was a complicated figure who is both responsible, you could say, for the defeat of Napoleon, but also for embracing many things about the West. And if you remember the last lecture, we concluded talking about how his death in 1825 sparks the Decembrist uprising, the hope on the part of forum, progressively minded aristocrats that they can get Alexander's throne and turn Russia into a constitutional monarchy that is more committed to developing democracy than it has been so far. In fact, what happens is Nicholas the First, comes to power, and what follows is at least remembered in historiography by Marshall Berman as a rather dark period in Russian history. It's perhaps one of the most backward-oriented periods in Russian history from 1825 to 1855. 1825, the defeat of the Decembrist uprising, to 1855, Nicholas's death and the defeat of Russia at the Battle of Sevastopol in the Crimean War. A couple decades in which we see the Russian intelligentsia forming, but really opposition to the forces of conservatism, which have never been so strong, at least not in recent times, in Russian history. This is where we basically ended last time. I want to sort of finish this slide simply by pointing out again, a wonderful quotation here from Alexander Herzen, one of those Russians, interpreters, and memoirists who best expressed, I think, this aspiration on the part of the newly emerging Russian intelligentsia to be progressive, to change the world, and who saw Nicholas I as the great obstacle to this aspiration. He claimed that without becoming Russia, Nicholas I ceased to be a European. Notice that even in the discourse of the day, the ideas of Russia and Europe are constantly being invoked. In his system, there was no motor. He limited himself to the persecution of any yearning for freedom, any idea of progress. During his long reign, he affected, in turn, nearly all institutions, introducing everywhere the element of paralysis, of death. We don't have to accept what Alexander Herzen says at face value. As an accurate depiction of the era. But it is an important indication of the mentality of the times and how the people who most aspired to change in Russia saw Nicholas I as their greatest enemy. How the notion that Europe might provide ideals and had provided ideals in the past to which Russia could aspire, that this was something that Nicholas I, in the aftermath of Napoleon and the aftermath of the Decembrists, was turning against. Russia was moving now in a different direction. So, to move to the themes of this lecture, which really grow out of this is a kind of introductory statement that I've made to you so far, take a moment here, first of all, just to make sure you've gotten my. The questions are that you should be prepared to answer for our first discussion. I'm not sure. I also wrote a note about this under the on the discussion block. But enough logistics for now. Back to the themes of European and Russian history. So My lecture to you today, The Springtime of the Peoples, Paris and London, 1848, is about what I would claim to you is perhaps the most important single date, moment in European history in the period that we are considering, the year 1848 itself. One of my aims in this lecture to you today is to give you a sense of why 1848 matters so much. Why 1848 is perhaps the most important moment in the making of the European Union, in the making of the Soviet Union, in the making of modernity as we know it. And I want to begin today's lecture by talking about the promises of 1848, the way in which all these amorphous ideas about modernity that have been brewing, we say, over the course of the 18th and the early 19th century come to fruition finally and achieve distinct ideological, political, social, cultural articulation. How the very ideologies that rule the modern world become apparent in 1848. Liberalism, socialism, nationalism acquire the meanings that we now understand them to have today. And I want you to think about those three ideologies: liberalism, socialism, nationalism, as three different answers to the question of the problem of modernity. How are we going to move into a world? How are we going to deal with that world? Each of those ideologies provides a slightly different way of making sense of that transformation. And then I want to look after this a little bit more closely at two cities, which are, and two countries, which are identified with the very idea of modernity: France and England, Paris and London, before casting a glance at Europe in the Russian mirror. There's a wonderful quotation at the very beginning of Karl Marx's 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. We'll talk a little bit about this text, but I was afraid I might never get to quote this to you if I didn't write it on the first slide. It's a useful reminder that many of these political economic theorists are also profoundly fascinated by language and see the whole problem of the creation of a new world as a linguistic problem. We often think of Marx as an economic thinker. He's at his most interesting, at least to historians, I think, in the 18th century. There's one text by Marx that is the one. Also, perhaps the most difficult one, but you've been struggling to build apart. But it's Marx before he has completely figured out what he thinks. It's Marx. Thinkers are most interested when they're still looking, seeking their ideas. And as you will find both through this text and his correspondence with Beres Sulich, Marxism has done Marx a little bit of a disservice. It's taken some ideas, forgotten ones. It's tried to emphasize only part for the sake of simplicity and for the sake of ideology, while losing perhaps a sense of a more complicated whole. But this quotation is Marx's claim about what it would take for the revolutions of 1848 to be successful. The beginner who has learned a new language always translates it back into his mother tongue, but he assimilates the spirit of the new language and expresses himself freely in it only when he moves in it without recalling the old and when he forgets his native tongue. Think about what this means. The creation of the new world order, the creation of what requires us to learn a new language and forget an old language. Somehow, the languages of the past hold us back. The languages are what will liberate us. And if we experience problems, we cannot achieve the goals we want. That's because we are constantly stumbling, tripping over the elements of the past. Let's look just a little bit closely at what these enormous promises are about 1848. I want to put Marx in a lot of context. It's not just about Marx right now. It's about everybody who was alive in 1848 took an interest in the promises of 1848. And in retrospect, you can see some of those promises as unfolding and developing the three great ideologies of modernity, of liberalism, socialism, nationalism, in their own ways. First, we might look at the French writer, thinker Victor Hugo, perhaps best known for works like Les Miserables. But it was Victor Hugo who, living through the events of the Revolution of 1848 in Paris, found himself radical Republican thereafter, and was forced to flee France into Brussels in exile, turning him into a Democrat in some sense. And in 1849, before he was forced to leave, at the International Peace Congress in Paris in August, he offered what I think is one of the most eloquent statements of the creation of a European Union, inspired by what he had seen in France in 1848. He says, "A day will come when you, France, you, Russia, you, Italy, you, England, you, Germany, you, all nations of the continent, without losing your distinct qualities and your glorious individuality, will be merged closely within a superior unit, and you will form the European Brotherhood, just as Normandy, Brittany, Burgundy, Lorraine, and Alsace, all our provinces are merged together in France. A day will come when the only fields of battle will be markets opening up to trade and minds opening up to ideas. A day will come when the bullets and the bombs will be replaced by votes, by the universal suffrage of the peoples, by the venerable arbitration of a great sovereign senate, which will be to Europe what this parliament is to England, what this diet is to Germany, and what this legislative assembly is to France." We can see the spirit of Napoleon kind of living on in the Revolution of 1848, this notion that a common European brotherhood is going to emerge from what we have just gone through. And if you notice, in the specific things he appeals to, refers to, there's a certain liberal cast to this vision. Markets opening up for trade is part of his vision of what a new and united Europe will mean, what it will encompass. An end to war, of course, this is something that most people hoped for in 1848, where bullets will be replaced by votes, and we'll have this kind of universal democratic system in which everybody's voice is heard. The promise of modernity, this promise of modernity, development of democracy, will finally achieve its fulfillment. I said one way to think about liberalism, socialism, and nationalism is as or various answers to the question and problem of modernity, how to cope with a world where everything that is solid melts into air. They are also each in their own way. Maybe this is a good way of trying to think through how you understand liberalism, socialism, and nationalism. They're each in their own way, a different way of democracy. The values aren't all of them. The way a nationalist understands development and democracy is a little bit different than the way a socialist understands development and democracy. Understands development and democracy. But development and democracy are common to them all, even though they each like to deny them to the other groups. How do we get a world where we are making people better all the time, at the same time collecting, giving them all a voice, so they can all participate in the development of themselves and of society? So I have labeled this, as you see at the top, a liberal promise. This is one of the promises of 1848. There were several versions of this, but Marx wrote his Communist Manifesto in the same year as well. If you didn't know that, now's the time to learn this. But in many ways, he wrote it as prediction. He wrote it in the first few months of 1848, before the revolution had unfolded, when it was still in the future. So when you read Berman's interpretation of Marx, which is mostly about the Communist Manifesto, this is really important to keep in mind. This is Marx hoping for a revolution, not Marx who has already seen it happen. Marx writes after it's happened in 1852. So Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, the German Jewish bourgeois and the German Lutheran industrialist, teamed up really to try to come up with a theory to explain how they could bring development and democracy to all people. Again, this is their goal as well. And how they could do this by empowering all members of society. But 1848 has a very different impact than Karl Marx, the impact it has on Victor Hugo. Victor Hugo is inspired by these events. He turns from a royalist into a republican. Marx, rather, you could say, loses some of his ideas. thereafter, his categories become more complicated. His understanding of the way the world works becomes more nuanced. The Communist Manifesto of 1848 is a work of prophecy or prediction. Das Kapital, which he writes through several volumes a few decades later, is the attempt to actually make sense of the way the world economically works. But in between, there is the 18th Brumaire, which he writes trying to make sense of why the revolution that he thought would liberate all of humanity did not do it, in fact. This is something he shares with the liberals and the nationalists. Everybody's disappointed in the outcome of 1848. This is not a socialist sort of peculiarity. There's another voice, or there are many other voices here. You could say many nationalist promises to rise out of 1848. But a famous and important one is through a figure I've already introduced you to last week, Alexander Herzen, one of the key figures in the 1840s Westernizer and Slavophile controversy in Russia, who's really remembered as and defined as a Westernizer, although he has some sympathies with the Slavophiles as well. You could say he's one of those figures born of that conversation between the Chudaev initiates in 1829. But Herzen, like Marx and like Victor Hugo, all passes through Paris in 1848. They're all moving to the same places. They all end up moving to London at some point as well. And he is sort of impressed with the struggle to transform the world. And I think one reason why Herzen is so important and so interesting is that he, in his memoirs, he really expresses the questions, the problems of the day in a much more, you could say, eloquent, concise, rhetorically impactful way than almost anyone else. This is the crux of the matter, he writes. Will the Slavs, under the fruitful influence of Europe, realize her ideal and incorporate an aged Europe into their existence? Or will Europe incorporate us into her rejuvenated course? What's the future of Russia and Europe? Will Russia become part of Europe, or will Europe become part of Russia, basically, right? That's what he's asking here. He's very inspired by what he sees. He sees this is the moment of democracy. This is the moment when the people are rising up to take power into their own hands. And yet, like Marx too, he's disillusioned by 1848. And after 1848, he starts increasingly looking back to indigenous forms of culture in Russia that have been forgotten by modernity and asks whether this move to the future can be better accomplished by some indigenous Russian forms. One concept, one idea that I put on the discussion sheet, which we'll be addressing a few times in today's lecture, which is really at the crux of the Verso Sulich Marx correspondence, is the idea of the peasant commune. This form of the organization of land, of territory in Russia, collective ownership, that becomes, in 1848, 1849, is first noticed in that year, and becomes really, in many ways, Russia's contribution to the debate about socialism, for sure, and modernity in a larger sense as well. The larger point here is simply that Herzen, a Westernizer, enamored of Europe, finds in 1848, through these events, that he has been too optimistic, that all the forms and all the ideas of Europe will, on their own terms, rejuvenate the world, and that there might be something in his own national tradition that he should hold on to, or that the world should pay attention to as well. These ideas continue to echo over the course of the next few decades and centuries. Alexander Herzen, writing a few years later, perhaps like so many Russian writers, articulates these promises in their most extreme form. And their most radical, you could say, gives them their most radical expression. Man is freer than we are apt to think. We are standing at the edge of a precipice, and we see it crumbling. Twilight descends, and no guiding star appears in the sky. We shall find no haven but in ourselves, and the consciousness of our unlimited freedom, our autocratic independence. What all the revolutionaries of 1848 are promising and yearning for is some form of new freedom that will make this integrated development in democracy possible, which will be its cause and its outcome. These ideas about achieving this new kind of political freedom are expressed in Russia later on in various groups and sects, The Narodniki of the 1860s take it on as well. In the early 20th century, the socialist revolutionaries, or SRs, are also in many ways children of Alexander Herzen and Herzen's sort of vision of a national path, you can say, to freedom. So ultimately, the whole point of introducing Herzen as part of the lecture was to suggest that there are at least three different paths to modernity that we see emerging out of the revolution of 1848, a liberal one, a socialist one, and a national one. Sometimes they combine elements of each other, which is one reason why they're hard to talk about. Herzen is in many ways still a socialist, but he's a national. He has the national element as well. It's hard to tell even that he gives up on all forms of liberalism. The 19th century is a confused and complicated century in that sense. Now I want to kind of take a moment to step back from the intellectual history, you could say, of the revolution of 1848 and take stock of the geographical, geopolitical situation. This is a great map of Europe in 1848. What you'll see here is, with all those little red dots, those are all the places where revolutions happen. What's significant and important about 1848 is it's not Paris, in fact, that erupts. More people than ever before since take to the streets to demand their right to self-determination, in some sense. The revolution of 1848 is the moment when the people truly rise up. In the name of what? It's hard to say. But this is the kind of political geography that they're facing at the moment. One way to make sense of it all, I think, is to divide Europe into three parts. If we look at Western Europe, we see basically monarchies in many cases, but the same states that we have today, Portugal, Spain, France, Great Britain, with some minor transformations, are the countries of the modern world, or of contemporary times. But if we look to Central Europe, to what is now Italy and Germany, we see kind of a confused array of principalities, all of which are competing with one another for authority and for power. The problem then of the revolutions of 1848 for Central Europe are different from the problems for the West or for the East. In Central Europe, for Italy and for Germany, the problem is one of consolidation, bringing together these different territories in the name of a single national purpose, turning Bavaria into Germany. If anybody who's been to Munich can know that many of the monuments there bear the word a national theater, a national opera. They're not German national, they're Bavarian national. That the kind of countries we have today were created out of the struggles of the 19th century. And in Italy and in Germany, at least, the problem of how to make all those different provinces work together is really where the consolidation of these nations takes shape. In the East, we have a kind of different problem. The three great empires, which all eventually get broken up into many different constituent parts. The Ottoman Empire, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, the Russian Empire, so the Romanov dynasty, the Habsburg dynasty, and of course the Ottomans under the family. Remind you at this moment that the overall title for the lecture was The Springtime of the Peoples. This is a phrase that comes into currency in 1848. And I wanted to emphasize for you that whatever ideological form these movements take, the idea of spring lies in them all. If we talk about the Arab Spring, the Prague Spring, it's only because of 1848. 1848 invents, in the modern sense, of a renewal or awakening of peoples to their true best interests. Keep on saying it over and over again ever since. But what does it mean to awaken to yourself? Awaken. That's where these ideological struggles come. Are you awakening to yourself as a German, an Italian, as a member of the proletariat, as a member of the bourgeoisie? Who are you as a person? Are you a woman, a man? What are the categories by which our identities take shape? All of this, you could say, the identity politics, in many ways, is born out of 1848. The question of how to define who you are, what really matters, and the different competing definitions of that, or some of the earliest forms articulated in this year. I want to conclude this section simply by looking at how, at a part of Europe that is not, you could say, at the forefront, but where we see the confused nature of the claims and the aspirations that 1848 seeks to satisfy and to resolve. The Hungarian Revolution of 1848, where the Hungarian patriots, led by the journalist Lajos Kossuth, organized mass demonstrations in both parts of Budapest and Budapest, and delivered 12 demands to the imperial governor. I think it's a useful moment just to look at what kind of things they ask for, because these are the kinds of things that are being asked for throughout Italy, throughout Germany. Freedom of the press, independent Hungarian government, annual national assembly in Pest, civil and religious equality before the law, a national army, they want to, equal tax burdens, end of land tenure, juries and courts, a national bank, an army to take, they want the army to take the oath, to take an oath of allegiance on the Constitution, freedom for political prisoners, and union with Transylvania. What is the ideology behind that aspiration? Is that socialist? Is that liberal? Is that nationalist? It's all of the above. It's hard to say. Any one of those. They want a national bank. Okay, maybe that's not precisely what socialists would want, but they also want equal tax burdens, freedom of the press. The ideals and aspirations of 1848, when we look at them unfolding in any particular place, seem to in some ways be above and beyond any particular ideology. Ideologies form to give a specific direction to and articulation to these demands. But 1848 is an important reminder to us, too. Many of aspirations to the making of a better and a new world order don't have a clear ideological imprint, at least not in the way that they do today. And that perhaps even in the aspirations of today, we are often hampered by our desire to put things into a clear ideological framework. The Hungarian Revolution fails, like the revolutions fail everywhere. This is an important aspect of 1848. It's a disappointed moment of national and or of popular uprising. Well, these are the same demands in Magyar. I'd like to showcase the original languages wherever possible. But one of the reasons for the failure of 1848 are the armies of Nicholas I and Russia. Nicholas I sends 300,000 troops to help crush the Hungarian Revolution in 1848. And thereafter, Russia earns its reputation in Europe as the policeman of Europe. This is a kind of a motif that's used thereafter. One of Nicholas I's great contributions to Russian history, too, is the development of the third section, the secret police, and a kind of elaborate form of surveillance and informing that in which some actually local Baltic counts and noblemen participate. One of the most famous sort of members of the third section lived in the Tartu sort of it was the town next to Tartu at the time, but Kardalova, which was Tartu, Thaddeus Bulgarin was a local Russian member, you could say, of Nicholas's sort of larger security apparatus. So I want to turn in the next two sections of the lecture, having sort of now introduced you to the enormous optimism and the hopes of 1848 that earned it the title of a springtime, the spring and awakening, to what happens in the aftermath of this awakening and the way in which you could see France and England deal with it in different ways. In many ways, what makes 1848 so important is that it brings to all European intellectuals and to a lot of common people too the awareness that somehow the people aren't quite ready to rule themselves. And the question, when will the people be good enough to rule themselves, is one of the animating questions of European intellectual history to this very day. It's the question we confront when we think about the election of Donald Trump. It's the question we confront when we think about Brexit. It's the question we confront when we think about Grexit. It's the question we confront when we think about why the European Union is in the state it's in today. 1848 gives birth to this question. Why aren't the people good enough to rule themselves? And this is a question that's really born out of France, because it's in France that it seems that the people voted in the person who is most antagonistic to their own interests. It's a little bit like, in some sense, the election of Donald Trump in America made this a very easy lecture to give in the United States. Might be a little bit harder, but harder here, because the parallels are unmistakable. But to set up the revolutionary predicament, the failure, and its aftermath in France, for which Marx is then the really important interpreter in his 18th Brumaire here, we need to know something about the environment in which this happens. Paris, like the other cities of Europe, has been growing exponentially over the end of the 18th and the beginning of the 19th centuries. A city of 600,000 at the time of the French Revolution is, by the end of the next century, a city of 3 million. I'm going to skip this. We don't have time for that. Maybe we do. I'll try. I'll go back a little bit. In some ways, I think we can talk about England and France offering two different approaches to this question of making the world modern. The difference between Britain and France is important to note because in so many ways they're often compared and seen as being part of the same general trend of development and democracy when looked at from the outside. But I just want to point out a few important distinctions here. Going all the way back to 17th century philosophy, if the British are associated with empiricism, the form of reasoning that assumes the mind to be a blank slate, Locke's tabula rasa, the French are more often associated with rationalism, Descartes' I think, therefore I am. The problem of philosophy is the English problem of philosophy is how do I, out of the world, into somebody's head? The French problem is how do I get out of my own head into the world? Descartes begins with a question. The only thing I know is that I think, therefore I am. How can I be sure that this table exists, you exist, everything out there exists? Locke begins in the opposite way. He says, all of you exist out there, but how do I know that I'm thinking? These sort of distinctions between sort of the British, you can say, and or English and French thought and French development sort of culminate in the 18th century in the dual revolutions of the Industrial Revolution, which is identified mostly with England, the French Revolution, the political revolution identified with France. But we're left with a very interesting kind of solution to the problem of the relationship of democracy and development, which I want to sort of propose to you here. That in France, we have a revolutionary tradition. A tradition based upon overturning and overthrowing the existing regimes. France has had more revolutions than most countries have had constitutions, or most countries have had. And there seems to be kind of a lingering hope that by establishing through political means of a revolution, a democracy, we can eventually achieve the kind of development that we want. The English approach, you could say, is in some sense the opposite. We need to develop before we can achieve democracy. The English are very slow. They had their one revolution back in the 17th century. The government that exists to this day, but they never got rid of their monarchy. They've really stayed, in many ways, close to the past. They were very, England was very cautious about expanding suffrage, about incorporating the maximum number of citizens in the kind of guidance of the state. And everything has been done in a kind of gradual way. So these two sections of the lecture, this one here, revolutionary Paris and evolutionary London, will be about introducing you in some ways to these different kind of approaches to the relationship between democracy and development. The key figure for Paris is not actually a Frenchman here, it's Marx himself, because he writes the Communist Manifesto really about, not about all the revolutions of 1848, but about the one revolution unfolding in Paris. It's important to remember that when he writes the Communist Manifesto at the beginning of that year, he is proposing a kind of model for world historical transformation based upon the relationship of two classes. We won't go deeply into the Hegelian origins of this thought, but the bourgeoisie and the proletariat, and he proposes the history of the world as a history of what kind of struggle? Class struggle, okay. As opposed to what? If class struggle, then the reason why I left the blank there was so that you think about other possibilities. So 19th century is in many ways a struggle. Every talks about how somebody's struggle would be another one. What about species struggle? You can have struggle on the level of classes, struggle on the level of nations, struggle on the level of species. All these different ways in which the major theorists of the 19th century preoccupied with how to achieve development and democracy, how to cope with a world where that all that is solid melts into air. Understand one thing they all have in common, Marx, Darwin, everybody else, is that struggle is the basis of everything. Human life is struggle. That's one thing that they share, is a vision of life as struggle and progress as struggle. If there's no struggle, there's no progress. No pain, no gain, as people love to say. And we see something that the people often miss when they haven't read Marx or don't think about him, that the bourgeoisie has played a most revolutionary role in history. Communist Manifesto is not first and foremost about singing the praises of the proletariat and condemning the bourgeoisie. It's about claiming what the bourgeoisie has done to get us where we are today. And one thing sort of to make sense of reading Marshall Berman is what are all the positive qualities or features that Marx sort of attributes to the bourgeoisie? How and in what sense are the bourgeoisie, the people who own the means of production, the middle classes, how have they done something without which human history could not move forward? Why are they so important? How have they played a most revolutionary role in history? Now for the French Revolution that unfolds in 1848, you could say, is entirely an outcome or a product of the Napoleonic world that we talked about last time that I reminded you of at the beginning of this lecture. After the defeat of Napoleon, who are the people who come to rule France? They are the restored noblemen and monarchs of a previous era. But they've lost authority. They've lost their legitimacy. Nobody believes in them in the same way anymore. Louis-Philippe, the Duke of Orléans, becomes basically the King of France from 1830 to 1848. This is how he's depicted in various cartoons. He's made fun of as a kind of a pear. His face keeps on turning into a pear. There's no respect for these for these leaders. And there's also a sense that they don't know where they are taking France or the world. In many ways, you could say Napoleon has created an environment, the first Napoleon has created an environment in which revolution is imminent. It's tomorrow. It's happening. And in France, it starts to happen all the time. Every 20 to 30 years, there's a new revolution in France after this period. But the revolution of 1848, the most significant, the most important here, really begins with an economic panic in 1847. A lot of rich French people have been speculating in the English railroads, assuming that the Industrial Revolution is going to move more quickly in England than it in fact does, and they lose most of their investments. This leads to a deficit. The French government has to raise money quickly as possible. It starts organizing banquets, selling tickets to these really lavish meals. And to try to put people to work who have been losing their jobs due to the unemployment that has come from all of this sort of economic hardship. In February 25th, 1848, Louis Blanc, the socialist leader in the, of a provisional government in France, declares his system or program of national workshops, whereby everybody in France is going to be able to get a job, even if those jobs aren't entirely necessary. These national workshops are ended in June. People get upset. There's uprisings and a confrontation between, really, the authorities, the police, the army, and the government. About 3,000 people are killed. This is nothing like the violence of the first French Revolution, but it's still significant. And 15,000 people are exiled. Now, the problem of 1848, and I'm telling you all of these facts, these details, so that you can have something to work with when you're reading the Marxist text. Because Marx, like everybody at the time, knew exactly what happened at every minute of every day, pretty much. People were so fascinated with this. We don't care about this anymore. And this is so far away. But you have to kind of read your way back a little bit into the times to know what was at stake in some of these terms and some of these oppositions. Louis Blanc, you could say, in many ways, was Bernie Sanders of his own era. He was the kind of a socialist who was promising to unite people in the name of a greater and more, I could say, and more universal form of government in which the voices of the people would be heard for the first time. But after the June days of 1848, the executions thereafter, what happens by December of that year is the election by direct popular vote, the first time in French history where you have universal male suffrage. Women are not yet incorporated, but all men are given the right to vote. And who do they vote in to power? A cousin of the first, Napoleon the Third. Somebody that people really only know by name. A figure who is very similar in so many ways to Donald Trump. Who doesn't have much education. It's very... who is a developer. He's basically a real estate mogul who builds things. Somebody who has not even promised a kind of, whose main aspiration, you're saying, becoming president is simply kind of to fight the system. Whose message to the people, too, is not one of greater inclusion or incorporation, but one that actually ends up ensuring that the rich get richer and the poor stay poor. This outcome of the Revolution of 1848 has left this question in European, Russian, world history. This is the first election in which pretty much everybody gets the vote. In somebody like Napoleon III. Napoleon III has been, he declares himself emperor on December 2nd, 1851, basically ending the whole system of democracy that has been, that brought him to power in the first place. All the interpreters, or you can say all the theorists and thinkers of France at this point are trying to make sense of what has happened. Two very important sort of interpretations of Napoleon III's rise to power come from Pierre-Joseph Proudhon, the founder, you could say, of anarchism, and Victor Hugo himself, who we've already talked about. Hugo interprets Napoleon III as Napoleon le Petit, the Napoleon the Small. And yet, his argument is that it's all about his individuality, his personality. He ends up being able to smother all opposition and all alternative forms of ways of seeing the world. Kind of an opposite interpretation is that of Pierre-Joseph Proudhon, the founder of sort of anarchism, who sees the rise of Napoleon as the product of causes and effects that are in many ways determined deeply by economic relations. It's a deterministic explanation. So we have one deterministic explanation that says it was inevitable, and another interpretation that says it was all about the particular individual. This is where Marx enters the debate. It says basically he doesn't like either one. And he writes the 18th Brumaire of Louis Napoleon Bonaparte in order to offer a vision of history and the world that takes account of the forces that constrain us on the one hand, but also makes room for human freedom on the other. If you've read the first line, at least, you know, men make their own history, but they do not make it exactly as they choose. That's the line that expresses this problem. We make our own history, but we do not make it exactly as we choose. We do it under conditions that are given to us. The relationship between freedom and determination is a complicated one. And when you read this, and I hope you do, because I mean, it's a struggle, but it's worth the struggle. This is an attempt to answer the question that we're still debating to this day, and he probably does it better than most, about what is the relationship between human freedom and determination? How much freedom do you have to make your own life? The answer in some ways is the great question of modernity. Can I just go out there and say that I do anything I want? Or do I have to work with what I have? How much do I have to work with what I have? This is, say, a question sort of at the root of all political science, of all cultural theory. Figuring out how much we have to accept of the world we've been given before we can start to make the world we want. But Marx comes up with a very kind of articulate and eloquent, I think, kind of a phrase here. You can read it in the introductions, or rather in the prefaces. I haven't assigned them to you, but I give it to you here. He says, I, in contrast to both Victor Hugo and Proudhon, demonstrate how the class struggle in France created circumstances and relationships that made it possible for a grotesque mediocrity to play a hero's part. I've been pulling the third as a grotesque mediocrity, somebody who really has nothing to recommend him, and yet he has become so powerful, so important, so influential. So how class struggle in France created circumstances and relationships that made it possible for a grotesque mediocrity to play a hero's part. In history, those who rise to the top are not necessarily the best at whatever they happen to do, according to this and this interpretation. What often happens is that people who don't quite deserve their status end up with more status than they ought to have. So this 18th Brumaire is a text that it tries to explain this phenomenon more broadly. Why things don't happen the way we expected them to happen or the way we want them to happen. So this is the first Napoleon. Here's Napoleon III, kind of dressing up like his uncle or his... Something about the title. The 18th Brumaire of Louis Napoleon. He actually has names of the former French King Louis, and he has the name of Napoleon, right, of his uncle, the first emperor. But in many ways, you could say this is the question: what is it? How is it that French history, in a world where we're moving forward, or supposedly moving forward, has twice brought a Napoleon to power? If you remember, here's another sort of citation. Hegel remarks somewhere that all great world historical facts and personages occur, as it were, twice. He has forgotten to add, the first time is tragedy, the second is farce. Marx is using literary categories again to make sense of past and facts and the truth. But he's observing something that I don't think too many people noticed until he wrote this. After he wrote this, everybody noticed it. You remember this from the last lecture, the story of the first revolution, French Revolution, how it works out. There was an absolutist monarchy in France. King has absolute power, beholden only to God himself, according to the vision of the French monarchy. Louis XVI is the last great king. The first French Revolution breaks out in 1789 with the aspiration or the hope to reduce the powers of the king in some ways, to make the king beholden to the will of the people on some level. But the constitutional monarchy degenerates, or doesn't degenerate, it falls apart when the king tries to run away. And the radicals in the movement say that a constitutional monarchy is not enough. They want a republic. And they end up saying, we want a republic without the king. They execute the king. But the republic starts to crumble from within, too. And we culminate in the terror. As the Committee of Public Safety, led by Maximilien Robespierre, we talked about all this last time, so I'm going over it especially quickly this time, unleashes all this violence. Tens of thousands of people are killed in the name of protecting the republican spirit of the revolution. This all falls apart, and eventually the general Napoleon Bonaparte returns home and takes over power and declares himself emperor on 18th Brumaire. But Brumaire, this is where the title comes from. What is Brumaire? Nobody said. Exactly, very good. No, Brumaire, the French Revolution was revolutionary in more ways than one. Maybe more revolutionary than any revolution, in the sense that it was one of the few revolutions that tried to reinvent time, tried to create a new calendar that would be more logical, not based upon stupid pagan rituals like September, October, November, December, but something based upon reason and rationality. To divide the calendar into 10 months, not 12, and to have each one associated with the kind of weather that was characteristic of that time. So Brumaire was the windy month. It was in the French Revolutionary calendar. And the 18th of Brumaire was the day when Napoleon I seizes power, takes over. So when Karl Marx, of course, knows all of this. He's living in an era where everybody is sort of conversant in the language of the French Revolution. They know what these terms mean. We've lost all this since. We don't know how to speak this language anymore. We have to bring it back a little bit. But when he writes the 18th Brumaire of Louis Napoleon, it's an incredibly book that everybody in the day would have gotten. And it's an incredibly important statement about the return of the French Revolutionary calendar, the 18th Brumaire of the second Napoleon. Because what he's arguing, in some sense, is how French revolutionary history repeats itself. You might remember circular or cyclical is replaced with a version of time that is linear and moving forward. Now, Marx is noticing that in this modern era, where we should be moving forward along linear time, the circles are coming back. So when Louis Napoleon III or Louis Napoleon comes to power, French history has really gone through the same motions twice. In 1815, saw the restoration of an absolutist monarchy with a brother of Louis XVI, it was Louis XVIII, the Bourbon Restoration. This fell apart in 1830 when they established a constitutional monarchy, known as the July Monarchy, presided over by Louis Philippe, which fell apart when the Second Republic was declared in 1848. And we see the dismantling of the constitutional monarchy. And this all came to an end when a man named Napoleon seized power and later declared himself emperor. In other words, French history has gone through the same stages. Four stages, exact same four stages twice. The problem that inspires the 18th Brumaire of Louis Napoleon is the problem of how is it that twice, in the course of 6 years, produced the exact same cycle of regimes through its revolutions. Absolutist monarchy, constitutional monarchy, republic, Napoleon. Absolutist monarchy, constitutional monarchy, republic, Napoleon. Are we destined to continue doing this forever? Why is it that the merging proletariat, the merging forces of modernity, aren't changing the world? Marx is preoccupied with this problem, but so is everybody else. Modernity should be taking us to an unprecedented and new place, and yet the past seems to be repeating itself. Right, remember that quote with which I began. Until man has learned a new language, we speak our native language, and we are kind of trapped by that language. Until we learn the new language, the language of progress, modernity, and the future, at which points we are free to move on and make the kind of world order that we want. When you're reading this, the big question to ask yourself is, why does the revolution of 1848 in France fail, according to Marx? That's one thing to be looking for on sort of on every page. Who are the forces that make it fail? Why don't the people come to power? Why do we get another dictatorship, really, under the rule of Napoleon? According to the Communist Manifesto, the proletariat should have risen up to take from the bourgeoisie. That would have been the end of the story. But that's not what happened. So Marx is trying to figure out why it doesn't happen. And as you're looking for this, note some players here. What is the role of the army? What is the role of the peasantry? What is the role of the various factions and groups within politics? The great outcome, you could say, of Napoleon's seizure of power, though, was enormous and very successful development. No democracy, but a lot of development. And under the Second Empire of Louis Napoleon Bonaparte, which lasted from 1852 to 1870, we see the transformation of Paris into the beautiful city we all know and love today. This is a picture of Paris before Napoleon comes to power, before Haussmannization. Haussmann, the Baron Haussmann, was an aristocrat who was put really in charge of making the city modern, introducing modern sewage system, for example, of creating wide boulevards that look like this as opposed to like that. It's one of the ironies, of course, of history is that we want to think, or Europeans want to think, that democracy and development together are possible. Keep on making examples where it seems things that we might develop in democracy. And this is part of course, what makes figures like Trump and Putin and Napoleon III so effective and so powerful. So this era, too, and I'll just make one little allusion here. It's a chapter we're not reading from Marshall Berman's book, a chapter on Charles Baudelaire, the French poet, and Flowers of Evil, because these are written in the era, you could say, of the Second Empire in Paris. And it's Baudelaire who coins or makes the word that we know in love or hate today. I want to turn now to England and London in particular, to look at how some of the same problems and questions of making of modernity come to a head in a world that does not experience revolution. Pretty much the only two parts of Europe that don't undergo a revolution in 1848 are Russia. Ireland even has a revolution at this time, but England doesn't. Norway, Denmark, all, most Scandinavia, all the German provinces and republics Italian principalities, all of these experience revolutions. Even in the Ottoman Empire has revolutions going on inside of it. But England does not. The last big revolution in England is at the end of the 17th century. They make peace with their monarchy and have a monarchy to this day, although in reduced form ever since, you could say, the end of the 17th century. So the question or the theme, you could say, for this section of the lecture is really how does England and how does London cope with the problems and questions of modernity in the 19th century? Two partial answers there on the subtitle, the idea of the gentleman and the survival of the fittest. We'll get to that in a second. Now, London is a more spectacular modern city in many ways than Paris. Paris grows to 3 million by the end of the 19th century. But the largest city in the world that gives its name to metropolis, is London, which grows from 1 million to 6.7 million, is more than twice, is two times larger than the next largest city in the world. This follows a period of urbanization in which much of the rural population is forced to move to cities. We see the emergence of slums in cities because people are forced off their land as peasants with the enclosure movement, with the privatization of rural holdings. And London is teeming with strangers who don't know each other and who are, you could say, part of this new problem and question of modernity. Middle of the 19th century becomes a city where scholars like Judith Walkowitz have written about a city of dreadful delight, narratives of sexual danger in late Victorian London. The Jack Ripper legend gets born in London in this period. The city as a center of promise and hope, but also the dark underbelly with crime infested with, you could say, a darkness and slums and the underclass. This is all part of the maelstrom of modernity in the 19th century in England. And when thinkers and people sort of encounter England, both sides of modernity, are both sides of this story, the darkness and the light, are visible. But to focus for a moment on the light, the Revolution of 1848 convinces or inspires England, London, and the British monarchy to prove to the world that it is at the forefront. And one way it does this is through the Crystal Palace exhibition at Hyde Park on May 1st of 1851. This becomes, you could say, the beginning of a tradition of world's fairs that we have seen ever since around the world. Various cities take on this role. Perhaps even Tartu's campaign to be the European City of Culture of 2024, in some ways, has its inspiration originally from England's or London's attempt to declare itself sort of the center of the world in 1851. This first World Fair exhibition of culture and industry, is what it is labeled, is about showcasing to the world everything that England has done, but it also creates booths for all the other countries, what all other countries have done for progress, for modernity, changing the world to make it better. Britain comes in first, France comes in second, and everybody else comes in thereafter. They have four different sections here, showcasing raw materials, machinery, manufacturers, and the fine arts. The British Empire is represented. They bring exhibitions and perform from India around the world to show all the ways in which the British Empire is invigorating the world. And this building itself is perhaps the most impressive thing on display. It's a marvel of architecture of the time. It's built almost entirely of glass. We're looking for a symbol of modernity that is transparent, that is bright, that is light. This is it. Berman finally gets to the Crystal Palace in his chapter on St. Petersburg, and I hope you'll read those sections. They might not be assigned for this week, but we'll read for next. The Crystal Palace is something that some 6 million visitors, one-third of Britain, come to see, and almost all the major figures of Europe as well. Dostoevsky goes to visit the Crystal Palace. I don't know if Karl Marx ever does it, but I believe Alexander Herzen does. This monument, this image, is the most articulate and most important, most powerful, you can say, attempt to convince people that modernity is a good thing and that modernity is possible in the form of a successful fusion of the will of the people, democracy, with industrial development. Britain is claiming that mantle. Here we have Queen Victoria at the opening of the inauguration of the Crystal Palace and its exhibition. It burns down ultimately in 1936, which is why you can't go to see it today. But it remains an important, you could say, artifact, sort of in British and in European memory, and perhaps gives credence to the idea, so some of the values of England that have become synonymous with values of modernity. The Victorian age becomes a thing, in the 1850s and the 60s. Queen Victoria, one of the longest lived monarchs in world history, reigned from 1837 to 1901. That's her reign, not her life. And brought, articulated, or her in her reign, the association of industry with empire and the various values by which humanity should understand and interpret itself were brought out. One concept that becomes very important in this sort of newly emerging modern world of Britain is the idea of the gentleman. So you could say in many ways the gentleman is a figure who is supposed to prove or demonstrate his discipline, his ability to control himself, somebody who is both the subject and the object of his own development, and then this ideal sense of a modern person, who is entirely in control of his own emotions and control of his own actions, who is a product of reason, his own reason, who doesn't let emotions take over, make him do things that he later regrets, who doesn't drink, at least not excessively, who is in control of his own world and those around him. This is also the period in which we see the cult of domesticity articulated and developed for women, and the notion that the gender roles become more clearly defined, you could say, ironically, in British modernity than they have ever before. If what women and men do in a rural environment or on a farm is often very mixed, in newly industrial Britain, the female and the male spheres are unprecedentedly distinct. Men go to work outside of the home for the first time, and women are supposed to stay there, at least according to the cult of domesticity of the Victorian age. Along the way, certain values become prominent and become the objects. I mention them here because a lot of the writers we're looking at, the thinkers, take these on or criticize them in one way or another. Many of the things that Marx is writing about, in fact, he sees for the first time in England. He moves to England at one point and stays there, really, for the rest of his life. Bourgeois respectability and virtue, at least the outward appearance of virtue, becomes very, very important. Making sure that we are acting in ways that are consistent with our moral standards. But at the root of all of this, something even, we would say, the idea or the promise of individualism that we talked about in relation to Napoleon and to the Renaissance, but the notion that every individual, in this case it's mostly the male individuals, is responsible for his own kind of destiny, and that you prove your worth by your ability to succeed in society. Along the way, we see the invention of some modern traditions. Christmas, as it's modern, contemporarily, as it's celebrated today, has a lot to do with Queen Victorian celebration of Christmas and the turning of Christmas into kind of a market that can be bought and sold. First Christmas card, for example, is sent in this year Merry Christmas. This was the very first Christmas card, I think, ever, where the royal family send their greetings and people started to imitate them. This was all possible partly because of her husband. Her consort from Germany brought the tradition of the German Christmas tree to England, and then it became a kind of a world phenomenon from there. Prince Albert of Saxe-Coburg and Gotha. I don't have too much time, so I do want to get to the main thinker, you could say, of this section of the lecture, Charles Darwin, maybe one of the major thinkers in Western history. Charles Darwin, in some ways, does for England what Karl Marx does for France. He's part or product of this culture of gentlemen, of the individual, of virtue and a bourgeois respectability. He's the fifth of six children of a wealthy doctor. He remains a committed Anglican and Unitarian. In his life, he doesn't see any contradiction between his own theory of evolution and religion. These things don't become a major problem nowadays. But it's in the 1830s when he is is taken aboard an expedition to the Galapagos Islands that he has his first he begins to develop his theory of evolution based on the divergence of various species when he observes the finches, these birds on the Galapagos Islands. And the theory of evolution by natural selection becomes, you could say, an important element of the larger cultural edifice of England in the Victorian age as well. These values we talked about before, bourgeois respectability, individualism, the gentleman, are also informed by the idea of evolution by natural selection. Now, Darwin's theory is so attractive and important and popular that in many ways he loses control of it. Other people start to articulate and interpret Darwinism. And there are many things that he's very reserved about himself, kind of a similar phenomenon with Marx here, too. But Thomas Henry Huxley, Darwin's bulldog, becomes the first great proponent of Darwinism. ultimately, this turns into, under the work of the social theorist Herbert Spencer, social Darwinism. It's Herbert Spencer who coins the phrase survival of the fittest, not Darwin himself. And this notion that somehow what Darwin observed in the natural world could be applied to our interpretation and making sense of human societies as well. A way of trying to understand success and failure, a way of trying to explain how those who rise to the top deserve their success and those who fall to the bottom deserve their failure. This is what comes out of, you could say, social Darwinism at the end of the 19th century. If people are not universally prepared to rule themselves, this is now returning back to the British answer to the question of why aren't the people good enough? It's because they haven't proved themselves to be the fittest. They haven't risen to the top. And the English sort of attitude towards universal suffrage is much more gradualist than the French attitude. If the French revolutions every 20 to 30 years declare universal suffrage and then take it away with a dictatorial regime and then give it back, England is evolving very slowly throughout this period. And it takes a long time to achieve universal suffrage, not really till very late. But there's no rush to get there either. The vision that not everybody is, in fact, worthy or deserving of equal kind of really representation within the system. A form of indigenous socialism comes to London too, and I want to point out kind of the evolutionary quality or character of socialism in London. Now, we should point out here that Karl Marx moves to London in 1849 to work in the British Library. Next to him, Alexander Herzen moves to London in 1852. They're both kind of working through the same problems and questions of socialism in London. So London is really important for the emergence and development of socialism in that sense, that both Russian and German thinkers end up there studying how the basis for making of a more egalitarian society. But there's also an indigenous English socialist movement known as the Fabian Society, founded in 1884 by Beatrice and Sidney Webb. And a lot of prominent British and English intellectuals join the movement. George Bernard Shaw, Emmeline Pankhurst, who was one of the first great suffragettes, campaigners for women getting the right to vote, and H.G. Wells, the science fiction author who we will be reading next week. They're all members of the Fabian Society. What we have here, this image here, is one of the two great logos of the Fabian Society. F stands for Fabian, S for society. It refers to an ancient Roman general who was famous for his very slow, conservative evolution to battle, who would never rush into things. What is this? Can you interpret what's going on in this sort of in this emblem? Why would this be the emblem of the Fabian Society? What's going on there? Wolf in sheep's clothing.
I guess it's like the revolutionaries pretending not to be so they can change society.
Exactly. Revolutionaries pretending not to be revolutionaries so they can change society from within. In fact, maybe we went too quickly there. They're not even revolutionaries, they're evolutionaries. They want to evolve the world towards socialism. How? By doing exactly what you're told all the time, going to school, getting a good education, a great job, and then once you're put in a high position of power, then trying to change something. The idea is that you can change the system by co-opting positions of power with the right mentality. That these Fabians would be like wolves in sheep's clothing. They would dress up and act and speak the language that everybody else speaks. They would not ruffle any feathers. They would not provoke any uprisings. The moment came and the time was right, could in fact orchestrate the making of a more egalitarian, better society from the top down. The other image that the Fabian Societies had was this one. This cute little turtle. When I strike hard.
It's very hard to believe. Well, I find it very hard to believe that this turtle is going to be strike terror into this, into anybody's heart. But the Fabian Society is an important movement, even though they might seem kind of marginal in the larger history of socialism. They found the London School of Economics in 1895. The London School of Economics has kind of lost its connection to Fabian socialism, but that's its origin. And the Labour Party in Britain is also born of the Fabian socialists and the Fabian Society. So, another person who's associated with them, of course, is H.G. Wells. And because I won't have too much of a chance next week to introduce him, I wanted to introduce him now, pointing out how H.G. Wells studied with Thomas Huxley, Darwin's bulldog, became a Fabian socialist, and became really interested in the questions of how a more egalitarian society and Darwinian go together. And when we read The Time Machine next week, the one fictional work, it kind of combines a vision of class struggle on the one hand and species struggle on the other in his attempt to imagine where a future society will go. What I've been doing for you in these last two sections, and I want to, just before we very briefly conclude here, is trying to give you a sense of how France and England both dealt with the problems of modernity that erupted, you could say, into everybody's consciousness with the revolutions of 1848. 1848 was important for its promises, for the optimism, for the springtime it seemed to offer people, but it was also important for fear that it inspired and provoked. Fear for the authorities, but fear even for people below who were prepared to handle a world of anarchy and disorder and disruption on the scale that 1848 seemed to anticipate. The French failed revolution that leads to Napoleon III reminds us that development and democracy often work at cross purposes. That taking a commitment to both democracy and development at the same time requires us often to work against what seems to be our own best interests. And the British example, or the English example, of Darwinism, an evolutionary sort of approach to development, reminds us of how slow it is possible for a society to change and to evolve in an era where it seems everything is changing so fast. Both France and England, as centers of modernity, become beacons and symbols for the rest of the world. Russians and Germans and Swedes and Italians all look to England and France on some level to get their bearings for modernity, for where they should go, for where they should develop. And it's no coincidence, I think, that both Karl Marx and Alexander Herzen end up moving to London after they spend some time in Paris looking for clues to how to better construct the new world order. But I wanted to conclude for you with just reminding you of the peasant commune, this kind of a blast from the past. This peasant, this institution from Imperial Russia that is really discovered in the aftermath of 1848. It's actually discovered by a German count, August von Hochsthausen. I wrote you something about him in my posting today, who studied agricultural economy, law, and folk songs at the University of Göttingen at the time of the Napoleonic Wars and thereafter, and spent some time visiting Russia in the 1840s. And it was in Russia that he was the first person really to notice that there was this interesting institution of peasant land ownership, the obshchina, or the mir, a kind of a form of collective ownership that he wrote about and noticed for the first time. This became very popular and important theme and subject thereafter for the Slavophiles. The Slavophiles, led by Kurevsky, started to talk about the peasant commune as the basis for a different kind of organization of society in Russia. But all of this comes to a head, this is my last slide here, with the figure of Vera Sasulich, a young revolutionary, the daughter of a minor Russian nobleman, who was attempted to assassinate an important political official in St. Petersburg in 1878. And thereafter was
really lived in exile as a refugee in Switzerland. It was from Switzerland in 1881 that she wrote a letter to Karl Marx, asking him to clarify the relevance of his theory for the development of Russia. And I've given you, as one of the assigned readings, it's very short, it's only like 3 or 4 pages, but this correspondence. So I'm asking you to notice when you're reading for our discussion on Friday and for your post, perhaps, what was her question to Karl Marx about the relevance of his theory for Russia? And what was his response? Karl Marx actually wrote about 10 different drafts of a letter. Some of them are 10 pages long. But the letter he actually sent, and this is the only one I'm giving you, was about 2 pages, where he talks about what it is that Europe perhaps, maybe not what Europe can learn from Russia, but what Russia has to offer the world that perhaps falls outside of his theory of capital and his theory of bourgeois and the proletariat and development. At stake here, my last sentence to you, is just, what does Marx believe that Russia can develop on the basis of its present commune, or not? Be thinking about